They formed in the mid-1970s during the first wave of punk rock. But Blondie has always blended musical genres from pop to jazz to reggae to punk and even rap, producing a number of hits including Heart of Glass, The Tide is High, Call Me, and the first number one rap song ever with Rapture. Their new release is called The Curse of Blondie. Now here to perform, Blondie.
A big disgrace, shaking your feathers all over the place. Throw the fist down on St. Mark's Avenue.
What a pity for you. And what a pity for you. Are those good boys? Are those good boys? Good boys never win. Good boys.
Welcome to Breakfast with the Arts. Very nice to have you here. It's been 5 years since your last album of new songs, and you're calling this one The Curse of Blondie, and it was supposed to be released 2 years ago. So is there a curse?
Approximately. You know, I don't know if there really is a curse, but we always, you know, kid around about these things. That, you know, things are always changing in this business. That, I mean, no matter how hard you plan, sometimes you just have to be very flexible.
Does that require a lot of patience?
Yeah, I guess so. Or just a sort of soon come attitude.
Well, let's talk about some of the songs on the album, because it's another eclectic mix of music. And let's talk about Shakedown, a cool mixture. There's some rap in it. Chris Stein says it's the best rap you've ever done. Do you agree with that assessment?
Yeah, I suppose. I'm still learning. It's quite a fascinating style, rap. And I'm not really naturally good at it, but I love it. I love it a lot. And I think that... you know, probably this is the best one so far, but it's really something that I really love.
And when were you first exposed to it? I mean, All American came out in 81, and Rapture was a huge commercial success, the first rap song to really succeed in a commercial venue. When did you first get exposed to it, and who were your early influences in that particular genre?
Well, I don't know if I can really sort of name any names, but I know that sort of like the early Sugar Hill artists and Grandmaster Flash, of course, a little bit later on, I suppose, or approximately the same time. And they would just had these big nights, you know, everybody would get up and rap, and they, you know, did all the scratching and stuff. And it was just great. It was so alive, and it was really, really exciting.
Did you think at the time, when it was in a sense in its infancy, that it would explode the way it has over the last 20-some years?
I don't really know if I thought about it. As a commercial thing, and but I sort of didn't think there was any problem with it either. I mean, I liked it, and it was fun, and what I really liked about it was that it was a very sort of positive voice. You know, it was like the vox pop, the voice of the people. You know, and it was just, you know, sort of coming straight out, and it was a fresh thing, and I really liked that.
And Shakedown is a pro-Jersey rap from a proud Garden State native of Hawthorne, New Jersey. Tell us about why you decided to come out with a song that's pro-Jersey, and is it true that you're trying to get this song on The Sopranos?
Yes, all of the above.
Okay.
Yes, simply. It's pro New Jersey, and it's also pro-New York. So that's pretty much it. And it's just sort of making fun of everything and everybody, and including myself, so... That's fair, right?
Absolutely. And we mentioned the eclecticism of the album. There's a rewrite of a traditional Okinawan folk song.
Yes.
Called Magic, or in Japanese it's Asuyoda Yunta. What's the genesis of this particular cut?
It is actually from a smaller island off of Okinawa called Yaiyama. And it's a traditional folk song. And it's about a very provincial girl who sort of loses her... purity and her sort of idealism and stuff when people from, you know, the mainland come and sort of disturb the peace and the tranquility of the little island. And they sort of, it's about the corruption of this Vestal Virgin of sorts. So we decided, well, I sort of was having this, reinvention or reincarnation about, you know, feeling a sense of personal magic. And I always have... sort of had that, and you know, sort of looked after that, and sort of counted on that in a lot of different ways, but you know, without concentrating on it, you sort of lose it. So I don't know. I was just talking to my friend Romy, who I write with, and I said, you know, I said I'm really out there. I'm looking for the magic. I'm looking for the magic. I want the magic back, and so that was how the song sort of evolved.
Translating or transferring one particular culture to another, is that more challenging in the studio, or is that a fairly simple process for you?
I think it was fairly straightforward on this. It was a nice melody, and we just did a very simple thing with it, and I thought it really worked. I don't know. I think music breaks all barriers and all boundaries. There are no real borders about music. And music has always been sort of an animal experience. As a matter of fact, I don't know if this is true, but I heard or read somewhere that music probably was what brought language to the human race. As there probably was no language. The communications were probably started through music.
And music has evolved over time with different genres coming forth. You were part of that in the mid-1970s when sort of punk, which had a large umbrella. I mean, a lot of things were sort of woven under that banner, fairly or unfairly. Uh-huh. On this album, you have a tribute song called Hello, Joe, for Joey Ramone.
Joey Ramone.
Tell us about that particular song and tell us about the influence he had on you guys.
Oh, I think Joey was a terrific guy, and he was always very sweet and pleasant, and I just admired the songs that he wrote, and I liked him in performance, and I thought that he was a real rock and roller. You know, he sort of dedicated his life to it, and he did a lot of things for other people. He always had these little festivals downtown, and he was really into it. He was just a real rock and roll kind of guy.
And you credit him and the Ramones, you credit Suicide, Television with Richard Hell. I mean, a bunch of other bands from that time period. You can still hear their influence in music today. Mm-hmm. But you don't so much toot your own horn, in a sense. You don't say that you don't hear Blondie's influence as much. Is that because we're our own harshest critics, or because you think your influence was less, or why do you think that is?
I guess I just feel like it's sort of obvious. I think all of those bands were influential from that period, and you know, we're one of those bands. So I think it was an interesting time because, as you say, you know, all of those bands were vastly different. You know, Talking Heads and Television, to the Ramones, I mean, to Suicide, to, you know, Handsome Dick, Manitoba, or something, you know, the Dictators. I think there was a great variety. It was a really interesting period. I mean, including us.
At that time, I mean, did you think it was fair, though, that everything sort of got woven into that same category? We compartmentalize so much in society anyway. It's like, oh, well, that's this or that's that. Punk was a very broad umbrella, and a lot of different styles were all underneath it. I mean, were you even aware of it at the time, and so to what extent did that serve as a hindrance to what you guys were trying to do, and being lumped together with
Well, initially, radio was really against punk. Mm-hmm. That got, you know, sort of bad rapped, so we really couldn't get any airtime. And it wasn't until they invented the phrase new wave that, you know, it sort of became, okay, we can play those records now because they're new wave, they're not punk anymore. It sort of served me well, though. I sort of feel like the punk attitude is sort of a good sort of, you know, gives you just a little, you know, you're just going to stand there and take it and just, you know, do what you want to do. And I think that you really have to have that. You have to have that kind of feeling about your art or your music or whatever it is you want to do in life.
How did you and Chris first come together? You were with Stiletto at the time?
We met at a club where the Stilettos were playing, and then he started playing with the band. And it was actually a trio.
And the evolution over time, I mean, to get that final nucleus that you had in 1975, what was the journey like to get to that point? People coming in and going out, jumping to other bands? Yeah, I would imagine.
It's the usual thing. I mean, there was a shuffle going on constantly, you know, different people playing and then, you know, falling out and, you know, playing with other people. So we were just part of that. It was, you know, just the way it went.
Is it true that the name of the band came from certain comments truckers would make to you as they drive by on the street?
Yeah. Street noise, yeah.
Street noise. And mm-hmm. So this was sort of a...
I could have called it street noise.
Yeah.
But I didn't.
much to our pleasure, for sure. You were pioneers at the time. I mean, you were the first band in 79 with your fourth album to have a full-length video component along with all the songs. Mm-hmm. You had the crossover, you know, with Rapture in 81. And at the same time, you became an icon. Fun, weird, difficult, all of the above. How was that period for you?
It was a complicated time for us because of you know, business pressures. You know, we had different problems in our, you know, with management and business management and the label. So it became very complicated. It was difficult. So I mean, I think had we had, you know, one of those elements in place that was, you know, really, you know, sort of working for us and saying, okay, you know, we can do this. You know, we probably would have stayed together and not had a reunion. You know, just one of those things.
But at the time, there was a sense of irony attached. I mean, the humor did come through for folks, and since there was a public perception of what fashion and image should be, and you were doing that with a certain ironic sense and sort of mocking it at the same time you were filling out some of those obligations. Is that fair to say, or were you sort of caught up in the PR machine and just kind of rolling right along?
Well, you know, that is very accurate, because the PR machine takes itself very seriously, as well it should. I mean, it is a, you know, it is a big business. But the irony and the sort of, you know, sort of laughing at myself or at ourselves was really a part of what we did. And I think a part of a lot of people's way of thinking, you know, you have to be able to laugh at yourself. Otherwise, you can't laugh at anything. And if you can't laugh at yourself, I mean, really.
And with that self-deprecation, the music always came first.
Yeah.
Fair to say?
Mm-hmm.
And I think the reason I ask that is because a lot of people see pop stars of today who are a lot younger than you were at that time. It's all about the image. A lot of stuff is lip-synced. It's the performance and the image and not the music that comes first. So what's your take on Christina Aguilera and Britney Spears and Jessica Simpson and others who are...
You want to get me in trouble, right?
No, I'm curious. I'm curious to hear your thoughts, because, as I said, the music came first with you guys. It was more than just the image. And I think today the lines have blurred somewhat. It's not so much about the music.
What's happened is that, you know, rock and roll has become mainstream, whereas, you know, the era that we came from, rock and roll was the underground. It was the counterculture. So I think right there that says it all. You know, I think you wouldn't have had a real rock and roll commercial back then, ever. You know, and now it's just ordinary. Everything is very accepted. I mean, time marches on. You know, we all it's our music. It's grown up. We've grown up with it. It's our music, and that's how we express ourselves, and that's not going to change. As far as, you know, the different artists, I think, you know, there's always been sort of this sort of split in rock and roll between showbiz and music, and I think that that's the primary, you know, primary criteria or difference. I think that for me, you know, I've always wanted to be in a band. I always wanted to be part of an ensemble. I like that feeling. You know, it's great for me. I just think it's terrific. Christina Aguilera, I think she could do anything she wanted. She's a terrific talent. I love the way she sings.
Now, you've done an awful lot of things in the realm of show business. I mean, when the band dissolved in the mid-1980s, you had a lot of acting work, had some solo work. You've performed with Jazz Passengers. I mean, you've had a chance to explore a lot of different aspects of who you are and what you'd like to do.
Yes.
Is there anything you haven't done that you'd like to do?
I haven't been a part of the space program, which really breaks me up. I wasted a lot of time doing all this other stuff, because outer space would have been it for me.
Well, me or me soon be gone, but there'll be other opportunities maybe to get out there. We'll have to wait and see what happens in the future. Of the different musical genres that you've been a part of, though, like we mentioned, the Jazz Passengers, always had a love of jazz? Always had a love of different styles of music?
Absolutely. Yeah, fortunately, I've had my head in the speaker of a radio since I was probably about 4 or 5 years old. And, you know, living in the metropolitan area, you know, I've really had a lot of great music over the years.
In 97, Chris is talking about getting the band back together.
Yeah, I wonder.
You were the most reluctant of the crew to come back. Why?
Oh, I don't know. Maybe I'm just, I don't know. I just thought he was nuts. And he is, but here we are.
And what was the turning point that was surprising to you when you guys first got back together in the studio and everything just started to click? I mean, what was it that turned the corner for you?
I don't know if there was any sort of one moment. I think the first time that we got together to play, of course, was very exciting and, you know, made me very happy. You know, it was really, you know, like a homecoming.
The Phasm 8 Tour.
Phasm 8, yeah.
Why are you calling it the Phasm 8 Tour?
Well, it is Phasm was the original working title of the album, and that's sort of like this ghost-like presence or something. I didn't make that one up.
No, check your dictionary. It's
true. Okay.
Yeah.
And the 8 was supposed to be, I guess, because it's the 8th record or something like that.
8th studio album.
But I wanted the 8 to be lying down like an infinity sign, so it would be like the ghost of infinity or something. I don't know.
Well, it's a pleasure for you to make time to come and see us today. Thanks so
much. Thank you for having us.
Our pleasure. Come back anytime.
Okay.
And check Blondie out on tour this summer. Phasm 8. Check your dictionary. It's true. Once again, Blondie.
La 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 la. Was that an invitation? Can you explain? I'm so impatient. Hey, rise to the occasion. Can you explain the reason why you took a second look, second look? Say, tell me, can you hear me? You gotta raise your voice, cause the music's loud. You gotta shout, spit it out. It seems that you've got a quiet way, eyes that tell what you can't say. I sure would like to read your mind. You're speechless and I tried and tried. You gotta la 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 la. It's like an application. You're filling in the open spaces, cause I've been overtaken. And I'm so sick of waiting for 1, 2, 3. Answer me, answer me. Say, uh-huh, before I come undone.